is no city on earth, in my view, that offers a working journalist more of an opportunity to examine the human condition and the values that define us as Americans than Buffalo, New York.
The terrorists can destroy steel and concrete, but they cannot destroy our spirit.
We are truly a city of light, not just because of our rich and colorful history as the Queen City of the Great Lakes and the city where the roads were paved to freedom, but because we are a passionate people. Passionate about the issues that shape our lives. And a people always willing to help others find their way.
You want to go in the shelter?
In the next hour, let's look back on a few decades together. Some stories filled with great pain and sacrifice. And others filled with joy and hope. It is my hope that in the next hour, you will get to know me just a little bit better, and why I believe Buffalo was the best city in the world for me to carry out my career in television news. Before I end my 46-year journey in broadcast news, I want to dedicate this video memoir to you, the people of Western New York, the greatest people in the world.
10 seconds. 50 golden years of Channel 4.
Stand by, satellite. Stand by.
Satellite. 2, 1, 2.
Baby boomers like me, who were born into the age of television, had a window to the world, unlike any generation before. And sometimes the picture wasn't pretty.
150 different attempts have been made in Congress to do something about the plight of the migrants. All except one has failed.
CBS's Edward R. Murrow set the bar high and inspired me to be curious about those for whom the spotlight seldom shines.
The lines of protesters ran about 8 across the street.
I got my start in Ithaca back in 1971 and helped develop one of the nation's early local cable nightly newscasts.
Here with a report on the Giant Rock Festival is WCIC's Bob Iger.
I thought this kid might have a future, but he only ended up being the CEO of Disney. As for me,
Rich Newberg, the eyewitness troubleshooter.
I never made his kind of money, but I got a wealth of experience and satisfaction that can't be measured in dollars.
What do you need now?
Food, clothes, shelter mostly.
I learned how to use television as a force to help bring about positive social change, often focusing on people who had fallen through the cracks of society.
I don't want to see my mom and dad like this.
This destitute family got their first decent meal and good night's sleep in weeks after I confronted the village mayor, who lived just houses away. After short stints in Syracuse and Rochester, I made it to Chicago at age 26 as the consumer troubleshooter, joining another budding journalist at the time, Jane Pauley.
Excuse me, sir.
You wouldn't interrupt the lady, would you?
Yes, I would at this point. He said he found that object in a sealed bottle. And we must address ourselves.
I would not.
I had taken on one of my station's biggest sponsors after this man showed me how he discovered a rat or mouse claw in his soft drink bottle. The company's president said it was impossible, but then viewers all over Chicago sent me their contaminated sealed bottles containing all sorts of material.
Looks like a lot of cellophane.
Turns out some of the recycled bottles were not getting cleaned out properly. But I found the consumer beat somewhat limiting and wanted to do more social issue reporting.
Good evening, I'm Rich
News Huber. 4 and Buffalo were everything I could ever have hoped for as a journalist. Right from the start, Buffalo's waterfront was intriguing to me, conjuring up all kinds of images of what life must have been like here in the days of the bawdy Erie Canal District.
I scarcely think we'll get another drink till we get to Buffalo.
I always hoped these gray ghosts of the past would come back, not to haunt us, but to help us rediscover ourselves as a city that helped America grow and prosper.
Buffalo reclaimed an important piece of its history today.
When we finally took our first real steps to develop our waterfront, wedding it to our great history here, I felt I was witnessing one of those iconic moments that happens perhaps once in a century.
And our hearts like our waters are mingled and free.
One generation built the Erie Canal, another generation buried it, in a new generation. This generation dedicates this project to the future of Buffalo in Western New York.
Era union so fruitful of glory shall end.
I had heard some of the best waterfront stories from Mayor Jimmy Griffin, who used to tell me about his days as a grain scooper in the holds of the big Lake Erie freighters.
You had the dust. And the dust was tough. We were talking about you had to wear the mask. You know, it's tough breathing with the mask. When we go to lunch, we go to a gin mook most of the time, and we used to say to swallow the dust.
Wash the dust down.
Wash the dust down, you know.
This is the way we put bread on our tables. We give you our sons, our hearts, and our will.
What history to remember you?
Now, about the late Mayor Griffin, if you didn't play ball with him, he might give you a hard time. But he gave us our baseball stadium, among many other things, told us to ride out our blizzards with a six-pack of beer, and never really apologized for saying what was on his mind.
The feisty characteristic that they put on you?
Well, you know, I don't know. Feisty, you know, I've always been, you know, pugnacious, you know, and at times I shouldn't have been. But it wouldn't be me if I didn't do it, right?
I'm going to miss the action, and I'm going to miss the people.
Whether the action was national politics and rubbing shoulders with President Bill Clinton or just meeting the people of Buffalo...
He's the best.
Thank you.
Mayor Anthony Masiello always demonstrated a love for his city.
The city of Buffalo is...
When I first joined News 4 in 1978, Councilman Masiello was the first politician I approached for the lowdown on city politics.
Yeah, you changed a little. You had that bushy mustache, a lot of hair then, Rich.
He welcomed the State Control Board to get the city's finances back on track and said developing the biomedical corridor was a key element in Buffalo's economic future. His door was always open to me, and he never stopped believing that Buffalo's renaissance was close at hand. This is what he told me as he wrapped up his three terms as mayor.
Nobody loves Buffalo more than I do. I can sell Buffalo to anybody, anywhere. Hopefully Byron will ask me to do some of that in the future.
Thank you for your belief in Buffalo.
The victory. Buffalo's first African-American mayor is elected.
For me, Byron Brown's election was another inspiring milestone for the city of good neighbors, growing from a vision that began a century earlier as the Niagara Movement.
It really was the beginning of nonviolent self-improvement civil rights movement.
This is not just a victory for me. It's a victory for all of us, for our city, and for our future.
How far we've come since the days when I started. They were the last days of Bethlehem Steel.
Sad day for the Lackawanna plant and for the people who have worked here.
A waterfront that seemed to be washed up and the demise of the Courier Express. But I truly felt that Buffalo's great history and heart would prevail, and it has.
After 50 years of talking about waterfront development, it's finally happening in Buffalo, and this is just the beginning.
Take a reporting job in Buffalo, and you know the nation's eyes will be upon you during those trying times in winter.
This car may be here for quite some time. It's a desolate area.
Mother Nature aside,
not guilty of the crime of murder.
We've been in the spotlight for a lot of national stories with local ties.
I want to know if I'll be able to grow up to be a normal man.
Love Canal was the big one when I arrived here in 1978.
Scream and holler and be heard.
It was my first exposure to the character of people in our region, willing to fight passionately for a cause, in this case, the right to live free of toxic chemicals in their basements. The most wrenching battleground in our streets took place in 1992, when Operation Rescue was invited into Buffalo by Mayor Jimmy Griffin. There were two opposing views with conflicting claims that could not be resolved in the street.
What are you doing to help unborn women? What about the next generation?
Number one, a baby comes out.
I called our documentary, co-produced by photographer Tom Vetter, our two most cherished rights, meaning the right to life and the freedom of choice.
Not the church, not the state.
Ask you to help him repent and to see
Dr. Barnett Slepian, an obstetrician and gynecologist who performed abortions, became a target for demonstrators. Dr. Slepian did not want to become a martyr for the pro-choice movement, and at one point reached out to me to state his cause away from the demonstrations.
As long as it's legal, I will provide total care to my patients, and if that's their choice, they're sure of their decision, then who am I to say that they cannot, you know, have an abortion?
But he was concerned that he was being targeted.
Not going to do anything about that single fanatic out there who's got the long-range rifle.
In 1998, he was gunned down in his kitchen with his wife and four boys in the house. Anti-abortion militant James Kopp was convicted of the sniper-style murder. A story that shook the world. The bombing of the federal building in Oklahoma City would also have Western New York ties.
Don't know what happened, just a blast.
Timothy McVeigh of Pendleton, a Gulf War veteran, had come to see our government as the enemy. He became convinced that federal agents used excessive force that claimed innocent lives in standoffs like the one involving Branch Davidians in Waco, Texas.
Shaken, disillusioned, angered, that could happen.
McVeigh's truck bomb killed 168 people in Oklahoma City. This home video of Timothy and photos of him as a child made it even more difficult for us to understand how one of our own citizens could engage in this type of terrorism.
The Tim that I watched grow up and, you know, come to really care very deeply about was just a very caring, nice, responsible kid. And to see him in the role of a terrorist, it just doesn't fit.
I got to know his father, Bill, a patriot who proudly displayed the flag outside of his home. In the only interview he granted before his son was executed, he told me what Tim had told him.
He told me that if he apologized, it would be a lie. So he said he wasn't going to.
The networks had tried and tried to interview Bill McVeigh. They just wanted to know, as a father, how he felt about his son. He finally broke his silence with me a month before the execution.
I think about Timmy, and that's the one before he went in the service. I call him Timmy, and he's Tim now. That's what I think about when he was a kid and full of fun and everything else. And I love you, Tim. That's about it.
These were my closing words, live from Terre Haute, Indiana, the day Timothy McVeigh was given a lethal injection.
Somewhere in the twists and turns of fate, McVeigh lost his innocence, and by taking the lives of 168 of his fellow Americans, robbed the country of its innocence. For now we know that terror can strike from within, without warning, and without remorse.
3 months later was 9/11. I toured Ground Zero with Governor George Pataki.
We couldn't stay home. We had to come and do what we had to do.
News 4 was there when volunteers from Buffalo assisted in recovery efforts. And we talked with Western New Yorkers whose loved ones had been taken from them so viciously.
One of the neat things about Len is that he would help people even when they didn't want any help. But he was that type of person. He was just a wonderful person. He's going to be deeply missed. I'm not going to be able to hug him anymore. I'm not going to be able to be near him anymore. So this is going to be very difficult.
Those who believe in God know that evil and death do not have the final say.
Another tragedy that brought us closer together as a community was the crash of Flight 3407 in Clarence Center.
Strangers who smile and nod to us, who come and embrace and hug us. It's something that's hard to explain in words, Rich. But that's our great solace.
We lost our loved ones because of bad practices, both in training and certainly fatigue.
I went to Washington with them when they pushed for changes in FAA regulations.
Safety delayed is safety denied.
And covered their march from Clarence to the airport when they vowed to make the skies safer for everyone.
We walk to honor our loved ones, but we're marching for a cause in aviation safety change.
It was yet another example of Western New Yorkers finding the courage and fortitude to turn a personal tragedy into an opportunity to work for the greater good for all. Sweet it's been to see Buffalo thriving again.
Buffalo's going to be back. It's going to be bigger and better than it ever was before.
With $1 billion earmarked by the state for growth and development.
Buffalo's on the move.
And yet, we are a city still struggling with issues of homelessness, inner city crime, and failing schools.
We're stagnated with infighting, changing superintendents, and in an environment where we see all kind of opportunity opening up for people, it's not happening for the poor and minority people in the city of Buffalo.
We are still one of the poorest cities in America.
Rick, hello.
It has always troubled me deeply to see the chronically homeless living in the shadows of the city.
You staying warm? Do you want to go in the shelter?
No.
Can I get your light
off?
Yep. Some I got to know, including Jeff.
Most of the time was a way of life. Survival was only in the real bad weather.
Jeff somehow survived for 2 years, mostly living around this shopping center in North Buffalo, until the blizzards and the bone-chilling temperatures of recent unrelenting Buffalo winters finally claimed both of his legs.
Pretty comfortable right now?
Yeah.
I followed his story, even as he was given his own apartment, thanks to the outreach agencies that are making great strides to eliminate chronic homelessness in Buffalo. But only months after I reported on Jeff's attempt at a new life, I learned that he had passed away, reverting back to drinking, compromising his health even further.
A life in the balance. Should we be doing more to help the mentally ill cope in society?
I raised that question 16 years ago, working with Tom Vetter, a gifted photojournalist with a deep social conscience. We entered the world of men and women trying to desperately eke out a life in boarding houses and on the streets.
I hurt physically and emotionally.
Sometimes I can't handle it and when I'm off my medication and I just try and commit suicide.
Okay.
They were existing from day to day, but many could have received much greater care.
You have to meet all the needs. If you meet only part of them, it falls apart.
Street gang warfare is another problem that I've covered for decades. This is from a series 24 years ago we called Growing Up Tough, about a West Side gang called the 10th Street Boys.
We wild, we crazy.
We
Can't nobody get with us.
It's the macho talk of the gang, whose members more and more seem to believe that they'll never survive Buffalo's urban ghettos unless they command their kind of respect.
We're like that, I mean. They do something to us, we gotta do something back to let them know we're here.
Today, vigils for young people shot and killed are now a routine occurrence.
Justice is gonna be served. Best believe that one. My type of justice, the type of justice we believe in, is gonna be served.
Even if we get them to stop shooting, resolve the conflict, there's still another group getting ready to take their place.
So how do you stop it?
So we need resources so that we can educate the community.
The massacre at the City Grill in Buffalo was one of the most tragic of all crimes I ever covered. After four people were shot dead and four others wounded, the man who would later be convicted, Ricardo McCray, was brought to me at Channel 4 by community activists Darnell Jackson and Bishop Perry Davis. McCray had feared a confrontation with Buffalo police and showed me he had no bruises or scars on his body and that he was not carrying a weapon. He wanted to turn himself in to authorities. I sat across from McCray, who denied he was the shooter.
You didn't do it? You say you didn't do it? Do you know who did?
If I know who did, I would come forward and tell y'all who did it, because that's a hurtful feeling.
How do you react to all those who were shot and wounded? You know, there are four burials and one guy is still critical.
It's like, that's real crazy.
Did you know any of the victims?
Yes.
Which one did you know?
I went to school with one of the victims.
I made no presumption of guilt and managed to keep calm, although I felt the tension of the moment, knowing McCray was the prime suspect. Later, I was told my colleagues in the newsroom were very tense. Buffalo police were called the minute McCray set foot on Channel 4 property. And after I finished questioning him, they were eager to make their arrest. But the story of Anthony Capozzi, who was falsely convicted of being the bike path rapist, was the crime story most gripping of all to me. For 22 years, Anthony's mother, Mary, faithfully prayed for her son, that his name would be cleared and that he would come home from prison. And many at Holy Angels Church had prayed with her.
From the beginning, they always believed he was innocent. And they were just praying for something to turn up, you know, to prove his innocence.
Buffalo cold case detective Dennis Delano, a hard-nosed, no-nonsense cop, would play a crucial role in proving Capozzi was innocent, and along with a task force of law enforcement experts, would bring the real rapist and killer, Altemio Sanchez, to justice.
Oh, my God. I have dreamt of this day so many,
my,
many
my
times.
My mom knows me very well. She knows I need help and care and attention. And I know, she knows me.
Cheers.
I was there when Anthony toasted his family and tasted beer for the first time in more than two decades.
How's it taste? Like beer, like it did before.
What I found most amazing was that he held no bitterness towards society.
It's all over now. I served the time they wanted, and now it's just follow the yellow brick road. Follow the yellow brick road.
Remember this night?
The great Jay's Buffalo sign once again towers over Main Street in Buffalo, New York.
Putting together the history of the Jays in the old newsreel style was a labor of love for me, because I always felt the preservation and reuse of Michael Jay's former movie palace would set the stage for the rebirth of the city. Tony Conti had told me how close the theater had come to being destroyed.
I found some maintenance people who decided to see how hard they could hit chandeliers with a football, so I took away their football.
But there was something magical about this Buffalo Jewel that stopped the final curtain from falling.
Felt like you were the richest guy in the world walking into a theater like that.
I got chills the night Main Street was packed with spectators, reminiscent perhaps of opening night in 1926, as the new Shays sign signaled a new era for the grand old palace. Buffalo's soul never left the Queen City, and I just loved reliving the golden age of jazz here.
It started on the riverboat. Yeah. Put that bale of cotton down. Come on, get on the boat here. And they play on the boat. That's how it started, on the boat. And that's our music. That's the black man's music is jazz.
Buffalo, with its dozens of nightclubs and dance halls, became one of the hottest jazz towns in the country. Little Harlem, the Moon Glow, the Town Casino, just to name a few.
And when I got here, like you could say, it blew my mind because everybody was blowing. Everything was happening. Every groove you want to mention was groove.
And just about every big name in jazz, including Louis Armstrong and Duke Ellington, played that Buffalo groove, paid the union first, played the major clubs, and then often moved on to a different kind of club at 145 Broadway, the Colored Musicians Club, where they would let loose until the sun came out.
Jam sessions where people would just open up and play like they've never played before.
You would stay open until 5 o'clock in the morning, maybe 6 o'clock in the morning. You go out, the sun is shining, and you're saying to yourself, my God, you know, how can I get home?
I gotta get my old tuxedo pressed.
It was great fun getting to know the great Town Casino MC, the late Lenny Page, who introduced the top stars of the day in Buffalo.
As far as entertainment was concerned, we were considered one of the top-ranking nightclub cities in the country. And we used to get, for three shows a night, we used to get an average of 800 to 1,000 people.
Going to Hollywood back in the 1980s was a real trip. Tracking down the Buffalo connections, David Milch produced Hill Street Blues, with police references often relating to streets we know here at home.
Richmond 318, Richmond, starting around 7.
I guess Hill Street is a kind of prolonged thank you note.
St. Elsewhere was a hospital show that also brought a sense of reality to the small screen. Buffalo's Tom Fontana took me behind the scenes on the set and told me his Buffalo upbringing taught him something about people struggling for better lives despite overwhelming odds.
What's great about the city is that people stay there despite the snow and despite the economic problems, and they have good lives, you know, they have real rich lives.
But I must admit, the most entertaining part of Buffalo Goes Hollywood was crazy Venice Beach. Photographer Phil Arno and I saw some really strange performances, and wouldn't you know it, Western New Yorkers were there too, watching with us.
Come on.
Yeah, I've been on here since August. Hi, Mom and Dad. Chihuahua, right near the airport. Went to Maryville High School. You went to Newberg?
Can you believe, now that happened.
International.
That was pure coincidence. We were looking for the Buffalo connection. We never thought we'd find it in Venice, California.
Rich goes Hollywood.
Well, Buffalo's everywhere. That's the bottom line.
Talk about another era. Were you there the day Crystal Beach closed? It was a day filled with nostalgia.
And of course they lined up for one last ride on the Comet. That roller coaster that will always symbolize the fun and excitement that was Crystal Beach.
Like a part of me is going out of me. I've been coming here every year with my children, my grandchildren.
It's actually a very sad day, but on the other hand, I have to look at the happy side of it for all the people, the millions of people over the years that we have made happy by coming here, having good, clean fun.
But Niagara Falls is here to stay. And when I had my first chance to experience it close up and personal.
Check that out. I'm touching the falls.
Yeah, a little scared on that Cave of the Winds.
Huh? Not anymore.
I guess that pales in comparison to what Nick Wallenda accomplished. Long before that stunt, I caught up with David Munday, the Canadian daredevil who went over the falls, and he shared a secret with me.
It scares the heck right out of you. You know, of course, I can't swim, and water terrifies me. This is a problem, and you're so scared of water.
The lore of the falls became even more magical and mystical as the mist coated everything it touched during our record cold temperatures last winter.
You just notice that these falls are recreating, clouds from the mist. So it's like, it's wonderful. It's like the nature is bigger than us.
It's a sight I will never forget. Visitors braved 13 below zero temperatures that day, but put up with the cold to see one of the wonders of the world.
The beauty is the first, how the God can do like this thing.
Wow, it's beautiful. It's worth braving the cold.
For a local reporter from Buffalo, the chance to travel the world and grow as a journalist is a blessing in itself.
Buffalo! Buffalo! Yes!
I followed the Buffalo story with photographer Mike Mombre Jr. wherever it took us, even to the feet of Pope John Paul II.
Your Holiness.
Come up here.
From Buffalo, New York. Your Holiness, a message, please, to Buffalo and Niagara Falls, how you want to be remembered to the people of Buffalo.
God bless all of you.
The Pope had special ties to Western New York with its large Polish population. He even traveled here as a cardinal. But the ties went much deeper. On that terrible day, when a would-be assassin shot the pontiff, the same bullet then entered the body of Anne Audrey of Buffalo. So to see the Pope, who would become a saint, bestow his blessings upon a Buffalo delegation on a street in Turin, Poland, was deeply moving to me. When the Pope died, Mike and I reported live out of Rome, and I can remember the outpouring of emotion and the crowds that had gathered, hoping to personally say a final goodbye.
It is an awesome sight, standing perhaps above a crowd of a million people.
I witnessed his last Easter Mass.
The Buffalo connections were everywhere, including a former Carmelite nun carrying an American flag. She had been cloistered at the monastery in Buffalo.
I believe that Pope John Paul the Great is a saint, so I'm not praying for him, I'm praying to him.
He had helped bring down communism in Poland, where I journeyed two decades earlier with photographer Don Yerke. I met briefly with a nervous Lech Wałęsa the night followers of Solidarity were rounded up on the streets of Gdansk by club-wielding police. But there were some lighter moments, too, with Dick Solecki, who just loved to kid around, especially with the kids.
Simon says, movie, break it a good.
They love Americans, and for this American with candy and playing games with them, that was probably, they're going to talk about that for years, this experience of this Polish American from Buffalo.
On our trips to Poland, we watched little Emilia Smolinska grow up after she had a hole in her heart mended at Buffalo's Children's Hospital in 1983. I remember her coming to our city as if it were yesterday. Now, the only Polish farmer I met, purely by chance, just happened to have a cousin in Niagara Falls. He brought the whole delegation back to his house, and we toasted with his homemade wine. Travels, we found that you could place Western New Yorkers anywhere, even in a desolate desert air base in the Persian Gulf. And they will find a way to keep thoughts of home ever present, with that kind of Buffalo humor that even makes the dog days bearable.
It's a new neighborhood, you just never know. Keeps the enemy away, haven't had a problem yet.
Our Air Force reservists from Niagara Falls were only a few weeks away from fighting the first Gulf War.
Living from day to day, who knows what's going to happen tomorrow?
Imagine you're a father and your son is with you, and you don't know what the future holds as Christmas approaches. Such was the case with Jerry and Anthony Leo.
I am concerned, of course. It's great for the holidays, but if there is a war, I'll be truly concerned.
Well, I'm more concerned about him than he probably is about me, because he's the one that's going to be flying into the war zone itself.
There were plenty of down times, too. I felt the pain of Anthony Delaney, who would not be there when his second child was born.
It hurts.
We saw that letters from home went a long way in keeping spirits up.
I pray that this thing can end peacefully and soon. I love you and miss you very much. I can't wait until you can hold me again. It seems like it's been forever. Remember how much I love you and take care of yourself. Love, Bridget.
When Buffalo cancer researcher Dr. Thomas Daugherty journeyed to China in 1983, we were there with him to see firsthand how his unique way to shrink tumors was giving relief to people like this peasant farmer who would have lost his only good hand to cancer.
Now I can use my hand in every way. This works well. There's no trouble at all.
I got to experience the mainland as it was opening up to Westerners, and my diplomacy was limited to a friendly musical duel with a street vendor selling a tiny mouth instrument. Here in China, I met some chefs who had trained, guess where?
I think I learned lots in Buffalo.
Now, I thought that was pretty impressive, but CBS's Morley Safer, who happens to be from Toronto, didn't think so.
Just what the dusty traveler wants after a trek up the wall and through the Forbidden City, a little bit of Buffalo.
Now, CBS's president at the time, Gene Jankowski, who happens to be from Buffalo, did not take kindly to that comment. And after Safer was brought to the City of Good Neighbors and wined and dined Buffalo style, he took it all back.
I was determined when I came here to not apologize, having had one of the most gracious and spectacular mornings of my life. I apologize.
To Cuba back in 1992 was an eye-opener. Not too many people from the States got to go there in 92. We were there on a medical mission with Buffalo eye surgeon Dr. Amar Atwal and Buffalo plastic surgeon Dr. Jeffrey Mileman. The trade embargo had taken its toll on Havana, and in operating rooms, even plastic medical gloves and tubes were being recycled.
And the final drain that they're using to drain the blood, that has been used on another patient before.
And how would you like to be a patient on a conveyor belt as six different surgeons perform a different task on your eye?
I've heard about it, but never seen in person, and it's amazing. By doing one step of a procedure, I think they become master at it.
Despite the embargo, I found that most of the Cuban people I talked with were anything but hostile to the people of the United States.
People, America, is good for Cuba. People, America, good. People, America.
That attitude on the street was surprising to me because Americans and other foreign guests got to eat lavish meals while others went hungry in the slums of Havana.
The children, you just want to love and hug them all, and you'd like to give them everything you have.
Any nuclear missile launched from Cuba?
When I was a boy, I thought we were all going to be blown up because of the Soviet missiles in Cuba. I'm glad I'm around now to see the day when Cuba and the United States are beginning to get along, and when Buffalo's Roswell Park doctors will be sharing techniques and knowledge with their Cuban counterparts.
If people's lives get better, that's the rising tide that lifts government and it lifts society.
That spirit of cooperation we witnessed more than two decades ago. TV News has given me the license to enter people's lives. And on rare occasions, there have been stories to tell that have provided timeless lessons for all generations to come.
People should listen. Please listen to us.
For me, there is no story more important than the lessons of the Holocaust. And there is no plea greater than those of survivors who begged us to listen.
Listen for your own sake, for your children and the whole world.
These images, shot during the liberation of Nazi concentration camps, haunted me as a child who grew up in a Jewish home. During my travels, I would pray for the dead with survivors in a Krakow synagogue.
What has become of the Jewish community?
All were murdered or sent to the ghettos.
Back home in Buffalo in the early 1980s, I, along with photographer Dan Somerville, introduced our community to the men and women who wore tattooed numbers on their arms, but had avoided talking publicly about their experiences. But now, it was time.
First of all, we were shaved. Number two, we were tattooed. I wasn't anymore the same person. Like in an hour, I was transformed.
Charles Rosen shared his story of how his numbers served as a sign that he would survive.
A1827. So I tried to add to it. 1 and 8 is 9. 9 and 2 is 11. 11 and 7 is 18. This number means chai. Chai in Hebrew is 18. Chai means to live. So when they give me this number chai, I was thinking about myself. I'm going to live.
Gerda Klein, whose story would later go national in an Oscar-winning documentary, told high school students in Kenmore how she promised a dying friend she would not give up for at least a week while on a death march.
A week in those days was a very long time. A week later, exactly to the day, perhaps to the very hour of her death, we were liberated by American forces.
Gerda married her liberator, Kurt Klein. The most important stop on my life's journey was at the end of the tracks leading to Auschwitz-Birkenau in Poland. Somehow, a group of boys whose families were murdered here survived to tell their story.
The terrible reality of this place can still be felt in the ruins of Birkenau.
Henry Silberstern, a survivor who had settled in Buffalo, invited photographer Mike Mombry and me and my wife Lori to accompany men who were taken there as children and were now confronting their lost childhood.
It was like a hoarding place for human cargo.
I see the flames, I see the crematoriums of Auschwitz burning. I see the people walking in, I see my family walking in. I see them walking in the crematorium and burning. I see their faces, I see their hands reaching, and I cannot help them.
We
were thinking about death as a part of life, which is not normal for young people.
We were very conscious of it. Today they go to the gas chambers, tomorrow we go. But life was something very strange.
To this day, I can't believe that I knew what's happening, and I knew what happened, and I wasn't crying. I was not crying to this day. All through the years, seem to remember it by, I never cried. They must have taken something away from you, maybe feeling, maybe your mind. I don't know what it is.
I learned something about how resilient the human spirit can be and took a major step forward in my lifelong struggle to come to grips with the Holocaust.
Life is a beautiful thing. I think life is precious. Especially what we've been through, this is beautiful.
The art of being happy is to be able to accept what you have and not look back and regret what you didn't do or what you could have done. Just take what you have now and be happy with it. Accept it.
The story of these men was among the most inspiring during my almost four decades of reporting in Buffalo. Some had been institutionalized, but they all found a new purpose in life by building baby cradles and delivering them to needy mothers.
Wow, this is so amazing.
The story took photographer and co-producer Tom Vetter to orphanages in Ukraine, which had an interest in developing a similar cradle program. Tom was so taken by conditions for children there and in Russia that he and his wife Leslie decided to adopt a little girl named Galia to give her a second chance at life.
Sabaka.
She's adjusted like she's always been here, like she's just a member of the family. We cannot imagine that she wasn't our biological child.
It is truly a Buffalo story that just never stops giving. No reporter in television news makes the journey alone. During the last 37 years, I've worked with gifted photojournalists who are able to capture the human spirit in a way that conveys a story directly to the heart. My colleague and friend Mike Mombre Jr. co-produced this memoir with me. We shared some great memories together. I've been privileged to work in a newsroom that never betrayed the trust of viewers, a trust that started back in 1948 when Channel 4 became the first Buffalo TV station to sign on the air. Now we've got a new crop of young reporters who I believe will continue to earn your trust because of their journalistic ethics. And they also know how to do this really well. And my thumbs aren't working too well these days. I also owe my own family a great deal of gratitude. You've watched us grow over the years through the holiday greetings. They allowed me to chase my stories that often kept me away from home for long stretches of time. So now, Lori, I guess it's time to give back. And thanks to the people of Western New York, you made me feel like I belonged here right from day one. You are very special to me. You are the most genuine and giving people on earth. So one more time, Rich Newberg, News 4, good night and goodbye.